Welcome, everyone. My name is Andrew Edwards, and I'm the executive director here at Lakewood Center for the Arts. And on behalf of our board of directors, volunteers, and staff, welcome to the 17th annual Lake Oswego Reads. Thank you for being here. This is a very special, special exhibit. Yes, you can applaud. That would be. You are in Lakewood Theater, the Headley Main Stage. If you are new, could you raise your hands and have not been here? Why not? Why haven't you been here? give her free tickets. For a woman who is, are you paying for those? Yeah. This is the home for Lakewood Theater Company, and behind this curtain is a beautiful set for the play Doubt, which has received amazing reviews, and there's information out in our lobby, and I'll be talking to you. So I hope you can return and come see the many things that we do here at Lakewood. We have a whole host of classes, and there is a spotlight newsletter out there. Have to do a little pitch about what we are. We're very proud to partner with Lake Oswego Library and this program. Lake Oswego Reads, as we mentioned, is 17 years old, but this particular year is really very interesting to us. The sponsors, I want to make sure you know, who's helping make this all possible, the Friends of Lake Oswego Public Library, and you can applaud after them, they're good. Yeah. The Lake Oswego Review, which has done an amazing job of promoting our show, thank you, Review. The Rotary Club of Lake Oswego. They've been very generous. And of course, the Lake Oswego Public Library. The director for the library is here, Melissa. Please stand so everyone can acknowledge you. And if you haven't heard, the library is doing a little bit of visioning and trying to understand what the audiences and their constituency want for the future. So if you haven't been part of that listening series, Melissa would be happy to give you a whole list of opportunities to give your input about the library. And I know you can also do that online, correct, Melissa? And that website is?
LOPL.org.
The gateway to everything. Well, it's not the gateway to Lakewood, but thank you, Melissa. And of course, I have to do a special acknowledgement to the woman who makes this whole month work, the volunteer and special events coordinator, Nancy Nyland, who many people say I have had the good fortune to marry. And she keeps me on the straight and narrow, and it is good fortune. It is amazing. In the lobby, if you haven't picked up one of these, is a fabulous brochure that the Lake Oswego Review put together and everyone on the Lake Oswego Reads Committee, who, if you are on the committee, would you stand, please, and be recognized on the Lake Oswego Reads Committee? Thank you. But day by day by day, you can be infused with amazing opportunities to learn about this book. Unlike some other programs that you see, this is fascinating to me because Lake Oswego Reads really finds different ways to understand and appreciate the book. And you're going to hear tonight from the artists and how they came to their understanding of the book. Now, the person who made that all possible is the phenomenal artist herself. She is also our gallery curator, and her name is Jan Rimmerman. Jan?
Andrew, thank you for spelling my name right. No. All right, it's all good. No. Andrew's my boss. He always tells me what to do, and it works most days. Once again, I'd like you to give Nancy Nyland a round of applause for putting us all together. And what about that reception? Wasn't that amazing? We get to have part two after our artist talk, so that's exciting. So here we go. Lake Oswego Reads. I get to be in charge of 21 wonderful artists. Now, these artists are very well accomplished. It's an invitational. If people want to join our group, they get to contact me, and we'll talk about how the selection process goes. But here we have 21 artists. Four have been in all 17 years. I know, wow, that's amazing. And we have two brand new artists to Lake Oswego Reads this year, so that's exciting too. I hope, and you all get trophies for being here tonight for March Madness, final round, whatever. Yeah, so thank you. Okay, and with that said, how many of you have read the book, The Seed Keeper by Diane Wilson? What a choice. Thank you, selection committee. This was top notch. The visual verbiage in this book opened whole new worlds to me, the artist, and to everyone that gets to read this. The themes of relationships, ancestry, farming, seeds, growth, climate, pollution, relationships, I probably already said that, different institutions, and some I didn't really even know how they worked. Absolutely amazing. And tonight you will meet the artists. You will see their interpretation of how they were inspired by bits and pieces in the book. And every single year, we don't like draw straws and say, oh, I want page 27. Everyone gets to choose what they want to paint or depict. And every year, we don't have any duplicates. So we have some duplicate themes, but here we go. So with that said, it would be my extreme pleasure to introduce Natalie Wood, who is the Lake Oswego Festival of the Arts coordinator here at the Lakewood Center. This year is the 60th year of the festival, and it is June 23rd, 24th, and 25th. She herself is an amazing artist and well-known photographer, my friend Natalie Wood. Give it up.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for coming to listen to us speak tonight. So tonight, the part of Rosalie's Cabin will be played by the Old Binion House in North Las Vegas. When I was 14, I jumped the fence with an old 35mm camera, and it was the first building I ever photographed and printed myself. Decades later, I was back in Vegas, and I took a wrong turn, and I ended up back in front of it. I was stunned. It was still there. It didn't look any less dilapidated than when I was a teenager. But there it was, still with us. I scaled the fence again and took this picture. This house is my reminder of how far I've come. For many Native American peoples, however, that reminder never happens. They are dying from suicide at the highest rates in the nation, and that number is increasing significantly each year. This piece confronts what goes unspoken in every community far too often. It's about Rosalie and her mother, a cabin and a bridge, two different choices. It's about the shame and fear that breeds silence and makes people feel alone. But I'm not up here to make you all sad. The pink flowers coming out of the chimney from this old building means that someone is still in there, keeping the fires of hope and courage burning. It's printed on wood in honor of the seed that grew the tree that became its foundation. So tonight, I encourage all of you to become seeds in your own lives. We don't always know what a seed will grow into. We aren't guaranteed a beautiful flower, but each seed is worth keeping and planting and growing. So tonight, if you could just do me a favor, turn to the person on either side of you and tell them that they are worth growing too. Thank you.
She always tears at your heartstrings. So next up is Beth Verheiden, and she is an amazing artist. She has many signature memberships, and you're like, what is a signature membership? That is when an artist enters a competition or an association over and over and over again, and they get accolades for several years in a row, and they have a permanent place in that organization. So, Northwest Watercolor Society, Western Federation of Watercolor Society, the Watercolor Society of Oregon, all really difficult organizations to win this honor. She belongs to the National Watercolor Society, Watercolor West. She's in many publications, including the Artist Magazine and the Watercolor Artist Magazine, and she's in books, Splash, 17 and 21, many, many awards and honors over the states, regional, national, and she received the 2021 People's Choice Award at the Watercolor Society of Oregon show, and also the Outstanding Volunteer Service Award. So give it up for Beth Verheiden.
My goodness, thank you, Jan. It's really good to be here with all of you. It's great to be one of you wonderful 21 artists. So I've been thinking about inheritances lately, what they represent, what they can become, and how important they are in the forming of a person's values, priorities, and relationships. I've been wondering if an inheritance can become a person's legacy. And does it become a legacy only if the person receiving it accepts the knowledge and wisdom that comes with it, as well as the responsibility of caring for it? My painting titled The Inheritance is about all of these things. It suggests that an inheritance is a time-honored gift offered by one generation to another, and with the offering comes the knowledge of how to care for and nurture it so that the gift can be passed on once again. The receiver of the inheritance must remember and accept the responsibility of the gift so that it becomes the legacy of a family. And in the case of this book, it becomes the legacy of an entire nation of Native peoples. The importance of this cannot be understated or minimized. It is their heritage. It is who they are, and it belongs to them. All of us have this in common, a message of values, character, and a way of life to be preserved and honored. We have an inheritance to give, and we have a legacy to pass on. It is one that we hope is valued, honored, cultivated, and nurtured by those who follow us. And as I heard a wise old farmer once say, as he shared his own life story, that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. And now I get to introduce Janny Hoberg and talk about her painting a little bit. Janny exhibits her prints statewide, plus in Hawaii, where she is surfing with turtles right now. Janny attended Lewis and Clark College and earned her Master of Fine Arts degree in printmaking from the University of Oregon. Her awards are many, including the Lake Oswego Festival of the Arts 3 times. She won the Director's Award for the Art in Agriculture exhibit in Corvallis. She won the Best in Show Award from the Northwest Regional Print Biennial in Portland. Her work is in collections from Eugene all the way to Bulgaria. She is currently showing at the Lawrence Gallery, Portland Art Museum, Rental Sales Gallery. She's involved with the Sitka Invitational and also the Lake Area Artists. And Janny says of her piece, "The garden is a place of work, nourishment, education, and tradition, all passed on. We plant, store, then plant again." Janny says that in reading the book, she was brought back to her own grandmother, May, who saved seeds and bulbs from year to year. She would press tulip petals and give them to Janny. Janny's etching plate used in this painting started as a still life of tulips long ago, but she says she wasn't satisfied with it back then. She kept the plate and knew it would be changed and used someday. She says, "I wanted to add a female figure, and this book helped me to solidify that image. The book gave me a new meaning for the etching plate and also a new memory. This piece is also in honor of the reclaiming of traditions." Thank you.
Terry Neal is straight off of a plane from, I believe, from Costa Rica. She is a signature member of Colored Pencil Society of America, and she won Best in Show and the Mayor's Award in the Beaverton Art Mix. She also won the Best in Show in this Colored Pencil Society of America District Chapter 201 right here in Oregon. She has been recognized as a Wildlife Artist of the Year and for the Conservation Stamp Competition. She's won many other awards and is published in many colored pencil magazines, including also the artist magazine Strokes of genius. Here's our very own stroke of genius, Terry Neal.
Thank you. Thank you. Want to thank you so much for inviting me to participate in Lake Oswego Reads, and I'm just so honored to do this. It was so exciting. And this is my mixed media piece, The Gift. When I was reading The Seed Keeper, I was impressed on how the main characters were trying to reconnect to their cultural traditions and have normalcy in their lives after so much trauma. There was a lot of symbolism in the book, and that really struck a chord with me. I'm really fascinated how artists put symbols in their work. So I decided to create a piece based on these symbols. And symbols figure prominently in many human cultures. The stars that I've put in here with watercolor represent the ancestors, and they're always constant in the sky, just like your past and your cultural traditions. The crow, which I began with colored pencil because that's my big thing, is a symbol of transition in a lot of Native American culture, and it also was a symbol of the mother in the book, the lost mother. And also, crows can be a gift giver. If you've ever met a friend, made a friend of a crow, they can give you a gift, and this one's giving a seed. Then there is also the traditional willow basket, an object to collect the essentials of life and seeds and belongings and keep them safe. In the final part was the plants. Growing plants, you nurture your body and soul as you plant these seeds and sow them. And they're ever changing with the seasons. So when I created this, I was kind of thinking, here is constancy, here is transitions, and here is change. Again, I want to thank you so much for letting me show you my piece.
Terry is one of our brand new participants this year. It's now my extreme pleasure to introduce Jim Wilder, whose specialty is naked raku. He shows in the Art Center, Northwest by Northwest Gallery, Eutectic Gallery, the Rainspark Gallery, and through the Oregon Potters Association. He also shows in the Portland Japanese Garden and will be in the brand new Lake Oswego Open Studios this coming year. He's won many awards, one of which he's very pleased that his naked raku was shown in the Oregon Governor's Mansion twice. He's a former teacher from the Lake Oswego School District and a volunteer at the Children's Museum Clay Room. Give it up for Jim Wilder.
Well, that was very nice. Thank you, Jim. The voices advocating tried and true practices are the background drumbeat of current dialogue. Diane Wilson is keeping that beat alive with her book, The Seed Keeper. My inspiration for the black-on-black raku piece is Rosalie's garden. Each time the garden failed, Rosalie failed. Each time the garden grew, Rosalie found success. The raku platter shows the garden growing in stages. In addition to the imagery is the native pottery tradition of clay and open fire. The hand crafts the clay, and the fire leaves the mark. I've tried to remain faithful to these potters and the traditions that they have gifted.
All righty, Mary Burgess is a master gardener, signature member of the Watercolor Society of Oregon, member of Rainspark Gallery, also of the Lake Area Artists, which will be showing downstairs in the lower level here at Lakewood Center on April 21, 22, and 23, so don't miss that. She's a former art teacher at the David Douglas High School and just received her backyard habitat certification. I know, that was big. Okay, she is an award-winning baker and a lifelong artist. Mary Burgess.
Thank you, Jan. Good evening. My name is Mary Burgess, and the title of my painting is A Seed Keeper's Legacy. I work in watercolor and often attach my paintings to a cradled birch panel. The painting is then coated with many layers of archival varnish for protection. My intention in creating this painting was to illustrate the love and care with which generations of humans have passed on knowledge and tools required for survival. In fact, you may have noticed a subtle heart formed by the hands in that display that love. The hands represent the container of life and the work involved in preserving it. Passing seeds from one generation to the next was one act required to preserve life and ensure survival of subsequent generations. To showcase this concept, I recreated the moment that Rosalie received the gift of seeds from Darlene. Even though the family had been fragmented, the power of family bonds remained and the legacy preserved, even in the face of so-called progress by the big agriculture industry. I will never see the color magenta in the same way after reading this book. Thank you.
So Bonnie Garlington, we all know, is a tapestry artist and a weaver, but she actually started out as a potter. So she was putting her pieces into the kiln and then found out that her sister-in-law just bought a loom. She saw the loom. The next day she went out and had to buy a loom. And she borrowed a book from the library and taught herself how to weave. She never went back to pick up the fired pots. So here you have Bonnie Garlington and her beautiful tapestry here at the Lakewood Center today.
Thank you, Jan. It's good to be back again for another year. The title of my small title, stylized tapestry, is Three Sisters Stronger Together. As I was researching images for my piece, I came across multiple references to the legend of the three sisters who planted corn, bean, and squash together. The term three sisters gardening was new to me, as it was to Rosalie, who did not inherit her seeds or learn how to plant them until later in life. After the disastrous storm, she was advised to plant the three kinds of seeds together for their mutual benefit. The corn gives the beans a place to climb, the squash shades the roots, and the beans fix nitrogen in the soil. When you see my finished piece in the gallery, you will notice that it differs slightly from the image you see on the screen. Here you see an evenly colored ear of yellow corn, such as you would find in most markets today. I later covered it with small beads to represent the colorful kernels associated with what is commonly called Indian corn. The colorful kernels are the result of cross-pollination, which is something that the big agriculture businesses vigorously try to prevent. This form of companion planting has been practiced by native peoples throughout the Americas for hundreds of years, and it is still actively promoted by groups such as Dream of Wild Heart and Native American Food Sovereignty Alliance. The author of the book is associated with both of those organizations. This book made me aware of many issues facing Native Americans, and it also makes me want to try my hand at a new kind of gardening. I hope you found the book equally inspiring. Thank you.
Okay, next up is one, our other new participant in Lake Oswego Reads this year, Leslie Peterson Sapp. She's a through and through Portland girl. She's attended college in New York, returned home, and exhibits locally and nationally. She's represented in Astoria by the Riversea Gallery. And I am so pleased to let you know she's one of the featured artists in the D. Denton Gallery for the 223 Lake Oswego Festival of the Arts, June 22nd, 23rd, 24th, with the kickoff at Art Decked Out on June 5th. If you want to know more about that, talk to me in the lobby. Leslie Peterson Sapp.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting me to be a part of this program. When I read The Seed Keeper, one scene in particular presented a vivid image in my mind. The scene takes place early in the marriage of John and Rosalie. She has just moved in with him in his white, crumbling old farmhouse. One day, she attempts to walk through deep snow to a grove of trees across a large field, but cannot manage it. John silently provides snowshoes for her. With dogged persistence, she is eventually able to reach the grove of trees. About the same time in the narrative, Rosalie finds an envelope full of seeds that John's mother has stashed away many years before. Through trial and error, she learns how to grow a garden. In my piece, I integrate several objects and moments in time into a single image. A solitary set of footsteps lead into the empty expanse. A pictograph of a house, almost like a child's drawing, is simultaneously an envelope and hovers like a specter over the scene. In contrast, warm and earthy tones depict a cob of corn laying on the earth, seeds huddling in the soil, and a cornstalk reaching towards the sun. I see the envelope, the soil, and even John's old farmhouse as being safe places for seeds and souls to rest and incubate. From that place of rest, growth is possible. Because the house and the envelope and the other elements in the piece happen at the same time, I wished to create an encaustic-like effect and creating layers of different types. I wanted to create layers, and so instead of using encaustic, I used many, many layers of acrylic medium. And you have to see it in person in order to really appreciate it. You can't really see it in a photograph because there is depth, there's iridescence, and a little bit of sparkle in the snow. Thank you.
All righty. Leanne Streit is also straight off of a plane from Germany and Italy, so we're an international group now. Her pieces are an interplay of hand-woven material, object stitching, and painting. She earned a BA in art at the University of Northern Colorado, and a Master of Architecture at Arizona State University. She was an architect for 20 years and now combines the structure of architecture and the fluid creativity to explore fiber arts. Leanne Streit.
Thank you, Jan. Good evening. As Jan mentioned, my name is Leanne Streit, and my medium is fiber mixed media. The title of my piece is Healing Rain. After finishing the book, I looked up the words ancient seeds and came across an organization called the Alliance of Native Seed Keepers. When you visit their website, it has the following quote: "Unity cannot happen until we place our hands into the soil and feed each other." Their mission talks about a redevelopment of bonds, environment, culture, and health. In my piece, I wanted to show a renewed awareness of the need to care for our environment and to actively participate in restorative practices with Native populations. With this thought, I started with natural fibers, silk, linen, and pineapple to weave the base piece. The warp was set as a quadruple weave structure, which allows for 8 different color layers that were picked up to form the spring thunder and sky. The beads represent the rain that provides nutrients for the ancient seeds that yield a healthy environment. The bank of the river is a quiet, reflective place, with spring flowers showing the season's new growth. The grasses growing in the Blue River provide a place for wildlife to reside. The entirety of the piece represents the stewardship of Native knowledge and environmental practices, and where they facilitate a bond between the land, plants, people, and cultural traditions that will continue to be renewed. Once again, I appreciate the opportunity to participate in Lake O Reads and really have enjoyed being introduced to this book. Thank you.
Next up is Beth Yazari, and she's created art in Lake Oswego for over 20 years. She earned a degree in English Lit at Northwestern University and a fine arts degree at the School of Art the Art Institute of Chicago. She loves analyzing books and creating the artwork inspired for them is a natural fit for her in Lake Oswego Reads. She is a regular for Portland Open Studios and is opening her home in studio in October for Lake Oswego Open Studios coming up. I also want to revisit her wonderful exhibit in last year's reemergence at the Lake Oswego Festival of the Arts in the D. Denton Gallery, Beth Yazari.
Thank you so much, Jan, and thank you all for being here tonight. My mixed media painting, which I titled Song for a Golden Harvest, is a tribute both to Native American beadwork and to the inherent beauty of corn, which I feel a personal connection to as the granddaughter of Indiana corn farmers. I knew from the start that I wanted to create a harmonious mandala-like piece with a lot of interconnected natural imagery. I chose a circular canvas to reference the ceremonial drums and sacred hoop of Native American traditions. I brainstormed on a lot of possible compositions, but I had an aha moment when I read a beautiful line about Rosie's great aunt showing her the seeds she had saved. Opening one bag, she shook a few corn kernels into her palm and handed them to me, tiny jewels of lavender blue, rose, and cream. So tiny jewels made me think beads, and I began searching online to see if I could find colorful corn kernels to use in my piece. And I was thrilled when I found that some brave suppliers had taken seeds of heirloom gem corn in beautiful gradations of colors and drilled tiny holes in them so that they could be used as beads. My husband was like, "What are you yelling about?" in the other room. Once I knew that the corn beads would be the star, I came up with a radiating mandala design representing sun, plants, birds, and wind, with the seeds forming the rays of the sun and infusing the piece with life. I used a beautiful antique nine-pointed star Native American medallion for the center of the sun, sewed on tiny hand-carved mother-of-pearl hummingbirds from an antique necklace, and created golden ears of corn from Japanese delica beads. So in essence, this piece is a tribute to the seeds. Sewing them onto my painting by hand allowed me to spend many hours of personal reflection on the interconnectedness of human beings and nature. And I now have the honor of telling you about Diane Locati's piece. So I first want to tell you a little bit about her. Diane has to be one of the most dedicated artists exhibiting in this show. She is one of only four artists, as Jan mentioned, who have participated in all 17 L.O. Reads exhibits, despite the fact that she now lives full-time in Arizona. She is very active in many artistic roles, including serving as the president of the Contemporary Watercolorists of Arizona, judging art shows, and giving workshops for groups. She also has already won Best of Show in three different art shows in 2023, and one of her paintings was published in the January 2023 issue of the American Art Collector magazine. So here is her description of her piece for this year's show, titled Tassels at Twilight. Twilight is the time when the first stars appear in the sky. That is why I chose the setting of twilight to represent the star symbol of ancestors living in the sky. Then I thought of the river that was so often referred to in the book, both for the Indian name of Rosalie's son and the river that took her mother's life. To begin this painting, I decided to use a wooden cradleboard. First, I painted white gesso over the surface. When dry, I sanded the gesso to make a smooth surface to apply fluid acrylic. With a brush, blue and gold fluid acrylic was painted on the surface. Quickly, while the fluid acrylic was still wet, isopropyl alcohol was lightly sprinkled to achieve the texture that is seen in the sky and river areas. Cottonwood trees grew along the bank of the river that ran through the property of her father's land and the place where peace was found. With a permanent micron ink pen, the tree shapes were drawn in the upper left, connecting the tree roots to the riverbank and stretching over to the star of this painting, corn. The corn was also drawn on the surface using the ink pen. Tassels are dancing in the sky, mingling with the stars, and the corn leaves lead your eye down to the roots and the riverbank. Corn is the life-giving food that plays an important role as seeds and as the element that connected Rosalie with her husband. At this time, I decided to add black and a light yellow fluid acrylic to enhance the trees and corn shapes. With a small brush, Black paint was added over the ink pen for more emphasis. Then light yellow was painted in the leaves of the corn, added to the edges of the trees, and finally the circles and the tassels and stars in the sky area. The light yellow lines connect all the areas together and lead the viewer around the composition. Connections are important in both connecting areas in a painting and connecting with the land where we live, food we grow and consume, and with the friends and families that live in our lives. At the end of the book, Rosalie finally found these connections. Thank you.
Well, now you get to learn about me a little bit more. So I'm Jen Rimmerman. I get to be the great honor of being the curator of the D. Denton Gallery here at the Lakewood Center. And I am working with the Lake Oswego Festival of Arts this year. So Dave Hazlett and I developed rock, paper, turtle art for wetlands. So if you love turtles and want to save some turtles, World Turtle Day is May 23rd. Okay, you can find my work at the Portland Art Museum, Reynolds Sales Gallery, Rain Spark Gallery, Coos Art Museum, Rain No Light Cancer Museum in Bellingham, Jensen Art Center in Linden, Washington, and the Fairweather Gallery in Seaside. That's all I'm going to say, except for I do love turtles and I do play tennis. Okay, other than that, here we go. My technique here on my painting is called Seeds Through the Generations. Starts with powdered charcoal. Powdered charcoal is from the earth, so it was a natural beginning on watercolor paper. On top of that, it's almost my usual 22 layers of transparent fluid acrylics, and that's why it looks three-dimensional. The subject matter really hit me hard with the women of the generations, saving the seeds, keeping the traditions over hill and dale. Holy moly. So at the top, you'll see the skirt of one of the original women fleeing from danger with the two children. The seeds are sown carefully within the skirt. You'll see the little bumps underneath where the seeds go in. Then underneath the fringe, the seeds fall out and they get to be planted. In between there, you have the stars because they are the star people, and it's reminiscent of the star map found in Rosalie's father's office when she got, or I guess room, when she got back to the cabin as an adult. The river always runs through it, and we learn a lot about the world, the good, the sacred, the comforting, and the polluting with the river. On the bottom is a little bit of a giggle because the old aunt, I think it was Darlene, that was found finally as the family came together, was planting everything she could from the old seeds in her little tiny apartment on the third floor, stealing dirt from the rose garden from the city park. Well, that's a little bit like me, and all my friends are like, well, Jen, you're that character, so I'm the one saving all the plants and all the dirt. I don't steal the dirt this time, but anyway, so my piece is reminiscent of all the strong women saving the world. It's my extreme pleasure to announce Bill Bailey, who's up next. Bill Bailey was trained as a pharmacist, but he's been an artist for over, I think you said, 60 years. His subject matter is usually impressionism, landscapes, seascapes, and those darn eggplant and pears that always win every single award. He studied with many names that you all know would be Nelson Sangren, I'll say Phil Tyler, and George Hamilton, of course. He's had work included in a lot of really great shows, including the annual Northwest Watercolor Society show in Seattle and the Artists of Oregon exhibit at the Portland Art Museum. He's also a member and shows at the Watercolor Society of Oregon. So bring it up for Bill Bailey. Thank you, Jen.
I'm Bill Bailey, as you found out, and I have been painting for 63 years. So when I read the book, there were so many things that inspired me to paint. So in conclusion, I decided I would just paint kind of the whole complex or the whole story of the book in one painting. So what I did, I started with the ground, the brown part, dark area, and then the corn kernels are in the ground to germinate. Eventually, as the weather warmed, the snow went away, the corn kernels germinated, and then it became the green level. The green level is the new crop of corn that has a spring green color to it. Eventually, the corn is reached maturity. It then is harvested, and then the stalks start to dry. So that's why I have the golden brown color on the next level, showing the kind of the final part of the cycle of the corn plant. And in the background are the hills that surrounded the area that was always mentioned in the book. As far as the corn, I normally paint peaches, pears, mangoes, eggplants. So the corn was a new challenge. So I Googled a lot of pictures of corn stalks and came up with that one there. I felt the book was a great parallel between seeds and human beings, because as the seeds grow, mature, die, they save the seeds, and then they replant them the next year, just like in humans. You're born, you mature, you grow up, you eventually pass away, and then a new generation takes over. So I thought there was a great parallel between the seeds and the in humans. I want to thank Jan for asking me to participate again. I've done it, I believe, 12 years. Thank you, guys.
Hate it when the sign goes down. You kind of forget who we are. Okay, we're like Oswego Reads, the event is here.
Okay, so we're now Stuart Adams, who is a writer, poet, dreamer, and a connector with the earth. When he's not painting, he thinks about painting. True Renaissance man. Stuart is a modern artist living and working in the Pacific Northwest. His primal style is rooted in the neo-primitive style of early 20th century expressionism. He draws inspiration from art of all eras and continents. He explores the discovery of symbols and has a degree from PNCA. Good job. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Stuart Adams. I am a modern primal painter. I'm more interested in the creation of symbol and pattern than I am in creating an illusion of depth or form. When I received the Seed Keeper, I put it in my sketchbook satchel, along with my sketchbook and pens, and I went out to draw. After each chapter read, I drew in my sketchbook, drawing pictures of corn and peas and seeds. And those drawings became the inspiration for my painting. I tried hard not to make an image, but to make an object. So I wrapped my design around the sides of the canvas to make it more of an object than just an image. Painting with layers of acrylic paint, starting with green and working toward the violet color that I had envisioned. To me, the painting seed pod is a visual metaphor of how every individual is part of a greater whole. Thank you very much.
Well, next up is one of our artists that is working in a medium that he's not really known for. This is Dave Hazlett, stone sculptor, and he is working on scratchboard for our Lake Oswego Reads piece. He is known for his sculpture on Cruise Way, which will be returning next month, yay, okay. He's in the Gallery Without Walls. He has a basin here at the Lakewood Center that's been donated by Ed and Joanne Frankel. He is a co-founder of Rock Paper Turtle Art for Wetlands, and you'll find him in, well, his work, in public parks, community centers, memorials, and in private collections around the Pacific Northwest. He's a stable artist at the San Juan Island Sculpture Garden on San Juan Island, and the Portland Art Museum Rental Sales Gallery, and the best part, he is a solo exhibition opening downtown in the Pearl at Waterstone Gallery. You can start seeing it this month on Wednesday with how many pieces? 13 brand new stone pieces. His fingers are shorter this month. There we go. David.
Well, thank you for that lovely introduction, Jan. Title of my piece, Back to the Time Before, was from one of the aunts said that, who brought the soil into her apartment and grew, and I just thought, yeah, that's what I'll title this piece. So scratchboard is masonite with a layer of a thin layer of white chalk and then a thin layer of black India ink. What you literally do is scratch through the black ink to reveal the white. So every mark you make, you've committed. And that's the how this piece began. In this image, I chose one of the platonic solids, the dodecahedron, as it has 12 sides, the same as our year has 12 months. Ancient symbols adorn the five-sided panels that represent earth, water, air, female, male, perennial, lime, potash, manure, and the most recent ancient symbol, the test tube. Our dependency and interconnectedness to exist with water is a sacred vow we cannot cross. Yet here we are. The ring of vegetables and fruits are the annual cycle of food production contained in the seed energy. The same energy cycle that allowed Rosalie to fall back in love with the earth, producing her own garden and child. The vanishing lines represent the rows of corn. The honeybee, that poor honeybee, is flagging down anyone in the universe for a little help. And the moon and stars were referenced many times in the book, and the scratchboard was a good medium to present. Thank you. I am now going to read for Kara Pilcher, who could not attend this evening. Throughout the Seed Keepers, characters in different gardens found hope, connection, friendship, inclusion, peace, understanding, and a general feeling of being one with the whole world. 25 years ago, I was at a painting workshop on the island of Molokai with a beautiful garden that provided much of the delicious meals we enjoyed. Several artists at that retreat became part of the first art exhibition for Lake Oswego Reeds and continue today. We all feasted, shared, and laughed around a gigantic oval dining table, a great communion like the Knights of Camelot. I painted that garden, and in order to frame it, had to trim off the two sides a bit. The painting sold, and I miss that tangible memory. But I did use this little strip that I had saved and wrote about in this poem. The matting details continue the narrative, using green for vegetation, brown for the soil, and blue for the cycle of life-giving water. The seeds were saved from our garden last year, including apple seeds from the grafted tree given to me by my art friends. Our own fence garden plot in Silverton is 1.5 acres. And as you can imagine, a lot of work, but equally a lot of blessings, spending time with family and friends, and sharing food beyond our circle with the local food bank. It seems fitting that a painting of a garden done with art friends depicts the inspiration from a book about gardening chosen with the goal of nurturing and growing community. Thank you.
All righty, next up is Susie Cowan. And she's one of our 17-year veterans. She loves this event, and one of the reasons she loves this event is that the whole community gets together, reads one book, and as Andrew indicated, you get to go to all these fabulous events for the entire month. One thing that you do not know about is that on March 13th, all the artists got together and had an in-depth critique. Tonight you get a little snippet of what we talked about and what the artists feel. If you are like really interested and really want to pick an artist's brain and know how we think or not, Tualatin Valley Community TV came in and filmed us. It is, I believe, over an hour. It's a wonderful, in-depth, it's very intense. And I would like to thank TVCTV, Christo and Ivan, who are here tonight filming. So give them a round of applause. tonight, I think I heard that we're streaming live, and I don't know who gets to watch us, but watch out what you say when you walk out the door, because you'll be taped. And both videos will be, I believe, on the Lake Oswego Reads website. And yes, okay, super duper. So don't miss those. It's absolutely amazing. So with that, I also need to talk about my friend Susie Cowan, who is another award-winning artist. She also shows in the Portland Art Museum Rental Sales Gallery and shows around the Pacific Northwest. She, she belongs to the Octopus Clan, so you need to know that. Give it up for Susie Cowan. Yay!
Thank you, Jan. And, we all have to thank Jan for making this show happen every year from the very beginning. My painting is titled The Mouse Children. It's an acrylic collage that began with a fern print on thin translucent paper using a jelly plate. I printed the fern fronds both negatively and positively with acrylic paint and adhered the sheer prints to a birch cradle board. As my painting developed, the idea of our main character, Rosalie Ironwing Meister, trading corn for the wild beans that feed the mouse children through winter, resulted in the image of my little mouse holding a kernel of red corn. We see the dried beans she trades for, the fall colors signaling winter's approach. The interdependence of all of nature and its creatures regarding the seasons, planting and harvesting the sunflowers, foraging the chanterelle mushrooms and beans, and the exchange of gifts, that looking out for one of another, as all of nature does, is what I tried to represent. The broken cottonwood branch reveals its star medicine, and the stars in the sky represent the Milky Way from which the star people, the Dakota, came from. Thank you. And now I would like to introduce Lisa Weiser, who couldn't be here tonight. And her painting is entitled Cash. Lisa's a visual artist living and working in Lake Oswego, Oregon, drawing inspiration from the scenic Northwest, travel adventures, and reading novels. She works in watercolor, mixed media, acrylics, and oil. She's also an avid photographer. Lisa works from life both outdoors and in her studio. Her representational work is characterized by vivid color, great depth of space, and attention to detail. She credits her father for instilling a love of drawing and painting while teaching her to draw at a young age. She earned her Bachelor of Science degree in art education from the U of O, and her work can be seen at the Lake Area Artist Show in April, LO Open Studios, and the Fairweather Home and Gallery in Seaside. She wrote, "The image of the secret cache would not leave me alone as I attempted other subjects in the book. I once heard, paint what you love and know. The cache reminded me of the underground forts the neighborhood gang would dig, cover with a board, and top with leaves and sticks. The pits were not used to hide seeds or treasures, but as bunkers during our regular pine cone wars. I felt what it was like to be underground in our hand-dug forts, just big enough for a few kids to crouch and hide in. I knew the smell of the damp earth, which sent me back to my great-grandmother's old cellar beneath the trapdoor outside the kitchen. It was there where she stored her jars of canned fruits and vegetables stacked neatly on old wooden shelves built next to the earth. In this acrylic painting, you will notice a distant background, some bare trees, two large boulders, a larger tree, and a papoose holding a baby, a rock near the center, and a stick coming from the upper right side of the canvas. To the right are the folds of a skirt and the fringe of a shawl belonging to the individual probing the ground with a stick. Below the rock, near the center, your eye glances downward beneath the rock and layers of leaves. Deer hide and crisscross sticks protect the food for the next winter and the seeds for the next generation. I embrace the cache with all my heart as it represents the security in the safe keeping of life-giving food and supports the power of tradition from one generation to the next." Thank you.
All righty, we're getting close to the end. Hang on, yeah, we saved the best for last. So we have Sue Jensen up. She's been painting for 36 years, been teaching for 30. She loves the process of making art because it makes her centered and calm. She too thanks her dad for his encouragement, as he was an amazing artist himself. You know that lineage. So when you walk near Sue, you might notice that she smells of lovely honey because she works in encaustic beeswax. Give it up for Sue Jensen.
A little scary there, smells. Thank you all for coming. And thank you, Jan. I can only echo the remarks of the artists before me that the themes and the images in this book are strong and plentiful and worth thoughtful investigating in many ways with art. I would like to say kudos to the selection committee for finding a book for us that was open to so many interpretations, and hence we have a month full of activities around the book. At the time I read the book, I was unable to get to my encaustic studio and thus decided to ask a couple people to go upstairs and bring down supplies to approach the painting in another medium, acrylic and collage. Of the many images that struck me, there was the one where Rosalie was beginning her gardening work and decided to plant seeds randomly in her garden space, strewed them. So I made collage pieces to show the randomness of that garden when no rows or order existed. Following my abstract style, I began to place flowers, veggies, and very tall corn in a compositional hodgepodge fashion, keeping in mind the composition and the meaning. Then I took bits of little collage papers and formed them into the two women, representing Rosalie and her aunt Darlene, who are looking on at the success of the planting with love, thankfulness, connections, and relief at the power of each little seed. This painting is called Great Gardens from Little Seeds. To finish the painting, I brought in acrylic paint to tie all the bits together. Thank you.
So, true confessions, I skipped one of my favorites. So, guys number 17, I feel like I'm in one of those noises off plays. So, Leslie Cheney Parr. They're perfect. Thank you. All right. So 30 years of teaching at the community college. Now Leslie focuses on travel, painting, and entering competitions. She too has signature status at the California Watercolor Association, Watercolor West, and the Rocky Mountain National Watercolor Society. She also has signature status at the Watercolor Society of Oregon. She loves L.O. Reads because she loves to support local events. You'll find her work downstairs in 2 weeks at the Lake Area Artists, at the Print Arts Northwest, and the Portland Art Museum Rental Sales Gallery. She loves to paint and draw every day. Give it up for Leslie Cheney Parr.
Hello, and thank you everyone for coming. We all love our books, we love our libraries, and I hope you all love all of our artists. I do. Thank you. This is my painting. It's called Dakota from the Stars. And I needed to do a little research about the Dakota. And luckily, the Portland Art Museum happens to have a show with Oscar Howe, who is a Dakota. He is. His art is full of symbolism. And he did have some with stars. He also had some with buffaloes, movement, and the spirituality of the people. It inspired me tremendously, and my painting reflects that. I used the symbolism of the spirit of the Native American, the Dakota. If you look at visually, direct a path starting at the bottom left, clockwise, you make your way around, you will see the harmony that is expressed flowing through the clean, fish-filled waters, the water that gives life, the water that brings fish so that they have meat and protein, past the carefully planted fields, tiny people that you can hardly see on the right, the forests, the night sky, the day sky, the giant star from which the people come, and again, the clean water. Again, harmony, which we all need. Thank you very much.
All righty, back on track. Debbie Neely's up next. She has taught in two colleges for 20 years. She's taught art, computer, and computer graphics classes. She is a member of the Rainspark Gallery, Local 14, and the Broadway Gallery in Oregon. She exhibits in four galleries in Washington State and one in Idaho. Her biggest project this year is that she's publishing a book of her normal media's woodcut, okay? And it features her own haiku poems that she has written, so give it up. Debbie Neely.
Thank you, Jan. You're good. Good evening. The picture that I painted is called The Sleep Is Upon Us because it's the time in the winter when the seeds are resting. And the time period that I enjoyed in the book was the 1940s and 1950s because at that time, I was a little girl growing up in Iowa. And the city I grew up in was Galva, and it's only 165 miles north to go to Ulm, the story where the book takes place. Interesting thing about it is that at that time, everybody in Minnesota and Iowa all had the, find the right page, I'm sorry. They had the same climate, the same attitudes, the same politics, the same prejudices, and the same timeline. Everyone in town knew everybody else or about them, the good, the bad, and the ugly. My grandfather owned the grain silos in town and acquired some farmland during the Great Depression that would eventually pass to me. And as I'm reading this book, it doesn't dawn on me that there's something different about this farmland. The book was a memory trip of my childhood with a lot of blank spaces filled in by the book, and because I was not fully aware that the indigenous tribes were carried or forced off of the land, and the land then was given to people that wanted to settle there. And that's how I came upon down the road to have this land. And the thought that it was taken from the indigenous people really left me kind of speechless, and it still does. During the big land grabs in the 1880s, Iowa did not have land grabs, but they gave all the land to the railroad companies because they wanted the railroad companies to get together and decide how they could best get a railroad across the country, the Continental Railroad, and then to get products going east and west. Excuse me a moment. In 1879, after the railroads had settled their decisions, unassigned lands in Iowa were parceled out to individuals. And the earliest sale I could find in Iowa was in 1879, and it was to a person named Samuel Aldrich. In 1901, he sold that farm to a family called the family of Solner, and the Solner family still owns that land to this very day. In 1943, my grandfather bought 160 acres from Andrew Solner and resold it the next day to his aunt for $1. Doesn't happen anymore. My sister and I, in 1985, my aunt died and passed it on to myself and three siblings, and now my sister and I own the farm. It's been quite a revelation to me about that. The biggest difference between the farm in Ulm and the Galva farm was that the land in both locations was originally farmed by brown people, and now they're principally owned by white people and huge conglomerations. My since feeling speechless regarding how I became the owner, I have struggled to decide what to do about this great injustice to the indigenous people. Thank you.
So this book hits all sorts of chords that you don't even expect. And if you haven't read it, read it. And if you've already read it, read it again. Okay. So thank you again to the Lake Oswego Library and all the people that helped put on the reception. The Lakewood staff and the people that put together our wonderful slideshow. I apologize for blowing it on the one artist. Next year, I guess I'll just have to do better. What you need to know is that all the art in the Dedenton Gallery is for sale. If you do purchase a piece tonight, you don't get to take it home for quite some time. The reason why is it is a traveling art show throughout our state of Oregon. It goes to many libraries, and it will be back the first week of December, and you will be contacted when you can come get it. Please join us for the rest of the reception. Continue the discussion. Poke and prod those artists, and give those artists a big hand, because this is a little bit out of their comfort zone.